know much of anything about cars. And so I told you the story when my car broke down and I was completely helpless to fix that situation. And we talked about a story in Acts where there was a man who was completely helpless and could not fix the situation that he was in. That he was a lame man from birth. He had never walked before. But Peter and John came up to this man and said, you know, we don't have the power to fix your situation, but we know somebody who does, and his name is Jesus. And so Peter reached out his hand, grabbed the man, and lifted him up, and he was instantly healed and began to walk and leap and jump and went into the temple to pray with Peter and John. And it was such an incredible moment of celebration and joy in this man's life, but not everyone in the crowd that witnessed this man's healing was happy about it. And so today we're going to talk about the second part of this story and to hear what happened after this man was healed, how some of the other people in the crowd responded to this healing. So if you have your Bibles with you, I invite you to pull those out or grab one from the back of the pew, and we're going to turn to Acts chapter 4. We're going to begin reading in verse 1. You're looking for Acts chapter 4. And as you're flipping to Acts chapter 4, I want to tell you a story about a man named Oscar Romero. Oscar Romero was born in El Salvador in August of 1917. He was born in a really small town, in a really small village, but his parents made sure that he received education and continued to grow in his development. As he grew up, he sensed a call to become a priest. Catholicism was the main religion in El Salvador, and so in 1945, he was ordained as a Catholic. Let me give you a little context of what was going on in El Salvador in the early 1900s. By this time, coffee had been introduced to El Salvador, and so a main industry of the country was growing coffee. And how they would do this is they grew coffee on these really large plantations owned by these plantation owners who greatly oppressed their workers so that they could increase their profit. There was terrible exploitation of the workers going on during this time, but the government turned a blind eye to it because they benefited from the economic success of the plantation coffee growers. In fact, the government at one time suppressed a peasant uprising by killing 30,000 people. So that's a bit of the picture of the economic and the political oppression in early 1900s in El Salvador, where it was run, a country run by military dictators. Now you would think and ask the question, where was the church? Who were the people who would stand up to be a voice for the voiceless who were being oppressed on these plantations? You know, where was the voice, especially of the Catholic Church, which I told you was the main denomination in the country? But the Catholic Church was largely silent during this time because they had decided to align themselves with the economic plantation owners and the powerful military dictators so they wouldn't rock the boat and they wouldn't cause any chaos. It was into this context that Oscar Romero was ordained as a Catholic priest. And he was a very talented, well-educated pastor. His sermons were even broadcasted on the radio. And so it wasn't a surprise when he was elected bishop in 1970. Romero seemed like the natural choice. Those plantation owners and the military dictators, and like a good Catholic archbishop, he wasn't going to rock the boat and he wasn't going to trouble the waters. So he was elected as archbishop. All of this began to change, though, about a couple days into Oscar Romero's election of being archbishop. Around the same time of his election, there was a presidential election in El Salvador. However, the winner of that election was a military candidate of the already in power military group. And the people and the peasants of El Salvador were furious because they knew it was a clear case of electoral fraud. So 60,000 people gathered in this common plaza to protest the election of the new president. And they stayed there all day. And at night, one of the local Catholic priests came out to perform a service of mass over the people, and after they performed mass, some of them went home, but some remained in the plaza, and those who remained were subject to the bullets of the military. Around the same time, one of Oscar Romero's closest friends, a fellow Catholic priest named Father Grande, was murdered by the military in El Salvador. Father Grande was an outspoken person of justice, actually being a voice for the voiceless and speaking out for those who are being oppressed by the plantation owners and the military. But it was only a matter of time before him and two of his traveling companions were murdered by the military. It was an early morning, 5:30 in the morning. He was traveling from his church to a local town with a 15-year-old boy, an elderly man, and all three of them were shot and killed. Oscar Romero was heartbroken as he performed the funeral for these three victims of violence. And he was so convicted that he canceled every single service in the city that coming Sunday, that they had one worship service, one Catholic mass for the whole city, and 100,000 people came together at this Catholic mass. And these are the words that Oscar Romero spoke that morning. Persecution is something necessary in the church. Do you know why? Because the truth is always persecuted. Jesus Christ said it. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. And the persecution continued as several more peasants and priests were murdered, and the military even began to use some of the churches as barracks for their military campaign. But Oscar Romero, only about a month into his election as Archbishop, his allegiance was already shifting away from those plantation and political elite into the behalf of to be a voice for the voiceless of those common peasants who were being so oppressed. And his sermons began to spread with even more popularity. In fact, they were broadcasted on 5 different radio stations because he was being this liberating voice for the people who were so oppressed. And to show you how important and popular his sermons were, the government actually bombed his radio transmitter to try to stop the spread of Oscar Romero's messages in the country. He started receiving death threats, and some people even begged him to leave the country because they thought it wasn't going to end well for him. But he refused to leave and said that he would stay in solidarity with the people of El Salvador. On March 24, 1980, Oscar Romero said these, which ended up being his final words, while performing communion at a service in a local church. Oscar Romero said, "May this body and blood sacrifice for humans nurture us also, so that we may give our body and blood to suffering and to pain like Christ, not for self, but to teach justice and preach to our people. So let us join together in faith and hope at this moment of prayer." And after Oscar Romero said these words, right there, while presiding over communion, he was shot and killed and gave his life as a preacher of justice, of speaking the good news of Jesus Christ in liberation to those who were oppressed. I told you Oscar Romero's story this morning because I think in many ways it mirrors Peter and John's story that we're going to look at in Acts this morning. There's a lot of similarities between them, and Oscar Romero gives us a little more of a modern example of what it looks like to be a bold believer of Jesus. And so I want us to look at Peter and John's story and to figure out how we today can be bold believers for Jesus. So we're going to look at their story briefly through 3 different lenses. First, preaching, the second, persecution, and the third, prayer. So let's start with preaching. This is in verse 1. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, the priest and the captain of the temple, the Sadducees, came to them, much annoyed, because they were teaching the people and proclaiming that in Jesus there is the resurrection of the dead. So Peter and John had just healed this lame man, and Peter had given his second other sermon speaking about Jesus, who the Sadducees and the religious leaders crucified, but Jesus came back to life, and they were speaking about this power and the resurrection of the dead. But the Sadducees were furious. You remember, they thought they had taken care of the problem and they had killed Jesus, but now Peter and John are saying Jesus is back to life, and it's in the name of Jesus that this lame man was healed. And so they are preaching about the good news of Jesus Christ, but quickly they move from preaching to persecution because the Sadducees throw Peter and John in prison. Now, let me tell you a couple of things about the Sadducees that are important to this story. The Sadducees were the Jewish religious elite. They were the people in power. You could think about them as kind of in agreement with those plantation owners or those political orders in El Salvador, because they had all the power over the people. They had the temple police and the troops, so they could get things done or they could stop things from being done. They had the power to crucify Jesus, and perhaps Peter and John might be next. You see, they were in charge of the temple and the sacrificial system, and so anyone who threatened their power was a threat to them. They could take them out. They had that kind of power. The Sadducees also did not believe in the resurrection. They did not think it was possible for someone to die and come back to life. And so for Peter and John to say that Jesus, who they crucified, was now back to life, and it was through his powerful name that this man was healed, they did not believe it. And that belief alone was a threat to their power. And so they had to do something to squash this movement and to squash the threat of Peter and John. So let's keep reading verse 3. So they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who heard the word believed, and they numbered about 5,000. So now about 5,000 people are believing in Jesus and the resurrection of the dead, and this is now becoming a movement that's threatening the Sadducees and their power, and so they have to do something about it. So the next day, their rulers, the elders, and the scribes assembled in Jerusalem, and with Annas, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all or by what name did you do this? And I think this question helps us see the power dynamics in this story. They want to know who has the power. How is this man who couldn't walk, how is he walking? How was he healed? Who has the power here? You see, the Sadducees thought they had all the power. They're the elites, right? They thought they had all the power, but yet they had never healed a lame man. And here are Peter and John, two ordinary fishermen from Galilee who had healed a man to help him walk. And they want to know who has the power. It's kind of like a wrestling match where you have the Sadducees on one side and Peter and John on the other side. And who has the power? Who is going to win? And so then Peter, this ordinary fisherman standing up against these aristocratic Jewish leaders in their long, elegant robes with all their schooling and knowledge in scripture, Peter stands up to give a defense of how this man was healed. And he was filled with cornerstone that was rejected by you, the builders, it has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and realized that they were just ordinary, uneducated men, they were amazed and recognized them as companions, or some translations say they recognized them as being with Jesus. When they saw the man who'd been cured standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. So they ordered them to leave the council while they discussed the matter with one another. And so I kind of picture this moment. It's like a little like referee huddle, like when you're watching football and there's like a penalty that happened on the play, and you know it's a really big deal, and whatever call is made is going to change the course of the rest of the game. And so the referees kind of do this group huddle because it's a big call they have to make. That's kind of how I picture this. The Sadducees are like, okay, we got a big call to make. Like, this movement is growing. 5,000 people are now followers of Jesus. This is a threat to the temple, the sacrificial system that we oversee. We have to do something to stop this movement, but to put an end to what Peter and John are speaking about. But what are we going to do, right? We got to make the right play. And so they ask, what will we do with them? For it's obvious to all who live in Jerusalem that a notable sign has been done through them. We cannot deny it. They can't deny that Peter and John healed this lame man. It's kind of like when we all watch football and we have seen the play with our own eyes, and then everyone in the stadium, everyone watching it, you've seen the play now 15 different times and 15 different angles with all the different replays. You have seen what has happened. They have seen that this man has been healed, so they have to make the right call or else the people are going to riot. But to keep this movement from spreading further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name. So they called them and ordered them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. So that was the penalty that the Sadducees decided to give. They said, we're going to order you, don't speak anymore about the name of Jesus. It's kind of a minor penalty, right? They could have done a lot worse, but they said, don't speak about Jesus. But Peter and John look at the Sadducees, and it's like they're saying to them, okay, if you want to play referee, you tell us. Do we listen to God or do we listen to you? And we have to keep speaking and about the name of Jesus, because we cannot keep from speaking about what we have seen and heard. And so the Sadducees threaten them again, but they let them go, finding no way to punish them because of the people. For all of them praised God for what happened. For the man on whom the sign of healing had performed was more than 40 years old. And so the Sadducees, they let Peter and John go back to their friends to be comforted. And when they get together with their fellow believers, they begin to pray together. And I want to read this prayer for us this morning as we think about their boldness. Together, these early believers prayed, Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth, the sea, and everything in them, it is you who said by the Holy Spirit through our ancestor David, your servant, why did the Gentiles rage? And the people imagine vain things. The kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers have gathered together against the Lord and against his Messiah. For it is in this city, in fact, that both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, to whatever of your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, look at their threats, and grant to your servants to speak your word with all boldness, while you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus. When they had prayed, the place in which they gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God with boldness. Peter and John and those early believers were bold believers, that they prayed and the Holy Spirit shook the place where they were gathered, and they had that kind of boldness. They were bold believers like Oscar Romero, and their story moved them from preaching the good news to being persecuted and thrown in prison and trial to then this time of prayer together. And what I think these stories tell us today is how we can be bold believers today. We don't live in first century Palestine like Peter and John did. We don't live in the 1900s in El Salvador like Oscar Romero did. But how can we be bold believers today in the communities and the places where we are today? And I think this is really important because some of you know I was at annual conference this last week, and I heard a speaker talk who said, one of the saddest things about the church today is that we've lost our voice. The speaker said there used to be a time when the church would speak and people would listen. He said there used to be a time when the church would speak and people would listen, and they wouldn't like what the church had to say, and so they would fight against it. But today, he said, if the church speaks at all, often people don't even care what the church has to say, because we've lost our voice. We've lost our power. We've lost our boldness. And so how can we, as believers today in the 21st century near Chambersburg, Pennsylvania, how can we reclaim our boldness? How can we have the same kind of boldness like Peter and John and Oscar Romero? And I think this story shows us how to be bold believers. The first step I think we have to take is that we have to believe in the resurrection. Peter and John saw the resurrected Jesus with their own eyes. They passionately believed in the resurrection. That's what they were preaching about that got them in trouble. Believing in the resurrection is this fundamental belief that God is going to restore all things, that God is turning the world right side up again, bringing what was once dead back to life. And the resurrection of Jesus Christ, where Jesus died and came back to life, is at the center of the Christian faith. Our whole faith rests on that belief. If it's not true, if Jesus did not come back to life, then all of this is pointless. But if it is true, then it is profoundly true. It makes all the difference. If Jesus really came back to life, that means Jesus' resurrection is a parable are an example of every single one of our lives in all of creation, that God wants to resurrect every single one of us to new and abundant life and restore and redeem all of creation. It's not just Jesus, but all of us who can live a resurrected life. That is what the hope of the resurrection is all about. And that belief is revolutionary if you think about it, because it is a direct threat to the powers of this world. Because if you're in power in this world, and God is trying to rewrite the world and turn the world right back up, right side up again, if you're in power in how this world is in its brokenness, if God renews it and turns the world back right side up, you're probably not going to be in power anymore. And so if you're a plantation owner of a coffee plantation in El Salvador, if you're a military dictator, if you are the Sadducee, you probably aren't going to be in power in this new world that God is creating. And so the very belief in the resurrection is a threat to your power. And that's one of the reasons why I think the Sadducees hated the idea of the resurrection. And when you have that belief, you become fearless, because death is no longer a threat to you. If you believe in the resurrection, you have confidence that death will not be the end for you, that you, like Jesus, will be raised to new life. And so what's the worst that the powers can do to you? They can kill you, but that's not the end of life for you. It's simply a transition into this eternal, abundant life with God forever. And so when you believe in the resurrection, you have incredible boldness in Jesus Christ. I think that's the first step. The second is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. In verse 8, Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit as he gave his defense before those Jewish elite leaders. It was a direct fulfillment of Luke 11:11-12, when Jesus says, "Don't worry about it when they call you in front of those authorities, the synagogues, the rulers. Don't worry when they do that, because the Spirit will give you the words to say." That's what happened for Peter. In that moment of persecution, the Spirit filled him and gave him the words to say it. I think that's true for us today. That in moments of trial or persecution or questioning, God's Spirit can speak in and through us. That we should be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. I don't think being filled with the Holy Spirit is this like once and done matter, but I think it's a continual filling throughout our lives. I was thinking about it. I was thinking back to the half marathon that I ran a couple months ago. And when I was running that race, every so often there'd be these little water stations along the route. And so they'd have volunteers handing you these like little Dixie cups of water. And I was carrying a water bottle with me, so I would take the little cups and try to pour it into my water bottle. That in itself was kind of a bad idea, because I think I got more water on the floor than I got in my water bottle. But anyway, you know, I'm trying to fill up my water bottle because I'm using it throughout the race. And I think that's kind of what the Holy Spirit is like in our lives, that we have these little stations or these moments throughout our lives where we keep asking God to fill us with the Holy Spirit, to keep refilling us with that power so that we can pour it out into other people's lives to give us wholeness in the world today. And then the last step is prayer. After Peter and John preached, they were persecuted, they went immediately to their friends, the other believers, and they prayed. They prayed for boldness, and the place where they were meeting was shaken by the power of the Holy Spirit. And church, we should never underestimate the power of prayer. Never underestimate it as individuals, praying for God to break into our lives, but especially as a community, asking God to do powerful things in our presence and believing that God will do it. And church, I have seen this happen, and I bet some of you have as well. The most recent example I was thinking is a couple months ago, I was at this church conference where there were like 5,000 pastors from around the world who had gathered at this conference. And I was there with a team of other pastors from our annual conference. And at the last night of the conference, we were debriefing what we had learned over the course of our time there. And it became apparent that God was doing some really great things in some people's lives, giving them new dreams and visions for the future of what ministry could look like in their context. And so we called some of them together in the center of our group, and we circled up around them and laid hands on them. And we prayed for them. And we prayed for boldness, for God to guide them. And it was almost as if the room in the hotel where we met was shaken by the power of the Holy Spirit. And I can tell you this morning that some of those pastors that we prayed for are now doing new ministries, new things, new churches have even been started because of that time of communal prayer. That's the power of prayer. And church, you today, in the 21st century near Chambersburg, are called to be bold believers. And so it is my hope that you will reclaim that calling, that you will be bold like Oscar Romero, like you'll be bold like Peter and John. And I know we are a church in a time of transition. But even in this transition, in fact, because of this transition, we have to be bold believers, confidently believing in Jesus, to believe in the power of the resurrection, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and to be people of prayer. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your power. God, we know that without you, we're weak. We're forgetful and we fall astray. But God, you are the good shepherd who calls us back into the flock, who leads us beside still waters and strengthens and restores us. So God, I pray here in this space, in this moment, that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit. That your Spirit would fall afresh on us. That you would give us confidence to believe in the power of the resurrection. That you would help us to be bold believers, to be fearless for you. God, give us voices. Help us to discover our voices and to use them to tell others about the good news of Jesus and the work that Jesus has done in our lives. Give us confidence and faith and trust in you. God, restore and rejuvenate our power, our souls, to fill us up with your power, to send us out to be witnesses for you in this world. So in Jesus' name we pray. Morning, we get to celebrate communion together.